this recording?
Oh, it is.
Okay, so today we're going to be talking about Eisenhower's domestic policies. Go ahead and write down the question. Was it a time of happy days or anxiety, alienation, and social unrest? Was it Monday, Tuesday happy days? Thursday, Friday happy days? Is that what it was? Or was it more society of social unrest, unhappiness, that kind of thing? So again, was it a time of happy days or anxiety, alienation, and social unrest? Okay, here we go. So a few things we're going to talk about first are Eisenhower's domestic policy here. He doesn't have very much because he's mostly focusing on Cold War politics. But one of the things that he does do that's focused entirely on domestic and social issues is dynamic conservatism. What does it mean to be dynamic? If you're a dynamic personality, if you're dynamic person. Yeah, you're constantly changing highs and lows, or you're constantly changing your mind. Another way to think of dynamic is like pragmatic, right? It's very Jeffersonian is one way to look at it. Pragmatic conservatism. Because when Eisenhower was elected, he was a Republican. And what dynamic conservatism meant was that he was going to continue New Deal programs. He was going to continue New Deal programs. Which is pretty dynamic for a conservative to continue New Deal programs. Because when a Republican is appointed president, do you expect him or her to eliminate New Deal programs? Sure, because that's a very liberal or progressive philosophy. That's a democratic program. And so we assume that once a Republican came into power, he would get rid of the New Deal programs. But instead, he kept it. And instead, he kept Social Security and minimum wage, or he strengthened Social Security and minimum wage. So by doing so, he wasn't being your traditional Republican. He was being a dynamic conservative, not a traditional conservative. He's a dynamic conservative. He was willing to, again, change his mind depending on the situation, which again reminds us of which president of the United States? Jefferson. He's very Jeffersonian in that sense. In any case, when he thought about it, he said, should any political party attempt to abolish Social Security, unemployment insurance, and eliminate labor laws and farm programs, you would not hear of that party again in our political history. There is a tiny splinter group, of course, that believes you can do these things. Their number is negligible, and they are stupid. President Eisenhower, 1954. So he's talking about the small group of people that want to cut all these programs. There is a similar party like that today that has splintered off from the Republican Party that does want to cut things like unemployment, Social Security, labor laws, those kinds of things. Does anyone know what that party is today? The Tea Party of the Republican Party. And so I would assume, at least based on this quote alone, that if Eisenhower saw what the Tea Party was doing today, he would likely have the exact same response. This is a party that will be negligible in history, they will be forgotten, and they are stupid, according to Eisenhower. In any case, he's dynamic because he's not doing something that's typical of a Republican conservative. He's doing something a little bit different here. Other things that he did, he created the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare. I should probably write this differently. Health, Education, and Welfare. Health, Education, and Welfare. And these were supposed to oversee the New Deal programs. The purpose was to oversee the New Deal programs. What was I going to say? Health. Oh, yes. Today, what has happened to these departments? What happened to the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare? They split. Because, again, do you want one department to be in charge of health and education and welfare? No. So they split it up eventually. So you had Department of Health, Department of Education, that kind of thing. So he split it in order to make it a little bit more responsive to the needs of the people. Then one of the major things that FDR does is he creates the Federal Interstate Highway System. You guys know this. You guys use this all the time. I mean Eisenhower. Eisenhower created the Federal Interstate Highway System. Eisenhower created the Federal Interstate Highway System of 1954. The Eisenhower Interstate System. Folks, the purpose of the IHS was to modernize transportation in America. It cost us over $27 billion. And we built over 42,000 miles of highway. So again, $27 billion and 42,000 miles of highway. Or freeway, rather, but it doesn't really matter. What impact do you think this would have on America? What was the positive of doing all this? Yes, it modernized our transportation, so that's awesome. What else would this do to help the U.S. economy? We built 42,000 miles of road. Lots and lots of jobs. Created tons of jobs. It also increased suburbanization. Because would freeways make it easier to drive into the city? Sure. So would you be more willing to move out of the city now? Sure. You know, if it took me 2 hours to get into LA, I probably wouldn't go. Imagine taking, like, you know, Hacienda all the way to, you know, LA. Stoplight, taking like 3 hours. But with freeways, can you go pretty quickly? Sure. Even if you're going 30 miles an hour nonstop, that's still better than having to stop for like 3 minutes every like 10 feet. Okay, so this is a big deal here. It's so allowed for suburbanization. People are able to move further up. It also hurt the railroad industry, again, because, you know, railroads. But again, if you can travel by road, then you're less likely to travel by rail because our rail is still limited to, you know, those specific roads. Whereas with this, you actually have a lot of options. The other reason that it was created, though it's not as important, but it is important, but it's not the main reason, is it was also used for civil defense. And in particular, military mobilization. If America is ever under invasion or attack, how will this freeway system help? Yeah, it'll allow us to do what? Move our troops faster, right? It'll mobilize our troops faster. If Los Angeles is being invaded, look how many major roads will go to LA. So we have this major highway system now so we can mobilize our troops in the event of an invasion. So that's a pretty new way to go about doing things. So you have that going on. Now, there's this myth that you guys might hear that, like, the highway system also was mandated to have, like, every 5 miles there had to be, like, a 1 mile, straight stretch of land so, like, airplanes can land in emergency purposes. I haven't found any evidence proving that that is true. Now, I haven't found anything proving that it's false either, but nothing that I've read in recent years has proven to me that that is actually why they were created that way. So have planes landed on the highway systems under emergency? Sure. But I don't think they were intended for that specific purpose. Okay. So people will tell you, be like, I don't know, what's your fact behind that? Ask them to prove it. It also creates a car culture, guys, because now that you have highways, will people drive a lot more? Sure, because you are moving out further, so you have a car culture emerging at this time. You have drive-ins emerging at this time. So the car culture will change pretty dramatically in the 1950s because of the highway system. So you'd see the development of a car culture as well. Cars, drive-ins, that kind of thing. The other thing that he did was he guarded against creeping socialism. Remember how during the New Deal, we were afraid that our government was becoming too socialist, getting too involved in the economy? Well, he wanted to prevent that as a Republican, thus he's a conservative again here. And so you can see how he's sometimes conservative, but not other times. That seems like he's dynamic, he changes a lot. He went ahead and guarded against creeping socialism by reducing or cutting government spending. And government regulations. So he guarded against creeping socialism by cutting government spending and government regulation of the economy. And so is the government going to be less involved in the economy now? Sure, we'll spend less, we'll be less involved, and that's more of a Republican conservative philosophy. Let the economy deal with itself. Let the people decide what is good and what is bad. But yeah, guarding against creeping socialism. And then Alaska and Hawaii. So they become states in 1958 and 1959. And that's the end of that story for Hawaii and Alaska. Cool so far? Right. So let's talk about American society then. Now, what is Eisenhower inheriting in this new age of the 1950s? American society in the 1950s. Well, there are a few things that are happening in the 1950s. Number one, you got computers. Here they are playing StarCraft. Very impressive. And computers eventually here will emerge, and you'll start seeing development of personal computers. But again, this will be a very slow process. But again, you see personal computers slowly begin to emerge. But again, you won't have one in your own home for until like 1980s. Like personal computers are like offices, that kind of thing. Way too expensive for an individual to buy. But you know, if a company buys them, then you have like the one guy that uses the computer for the entire company. It's pretty good. You can like do things like add, subtract, type things, and that kind of stuff. It's good times. And then you have the changing identity of women again. So women change their identity all over again. Remember how after the war we went back to the cult of domesticity? Well, women were like, no way. That is not cool. I don't like that so much. And so women began to change their identity once again, and it was inspired by a woman named Betty Friedan, who wrote a book called The Feminine Mystique. The Feminine Mystique. And the argument in The Feminine Mystique by Betty Friedan was that domestic life is boring. And women should go out and join the workforce. That domestic life is boring, and women should go and join the workforce. She talks about how, you know, imagine the mundane life of a woman standing, you know, there in the home by herself, ironing for hours, only to make sure that little Billy's Cub Scout uniform was pressed and crisp. Is this all that life really has to offer for women? And then she was like, that's horrible. That's all you do? Iron and clothe and clean and cook, repeat? She said, no, women have so much more potential. You should go out and do something more. Because remember, what's society trying to get women to? Stay at home. We said, no, women, fight back. Do something more. Be involved. And so, yeah, women went out and worked more. Look, there's a Fallout Shelter sign. Yep, just in case. But you also have the emergence of sexual allure in this 1950s time period, especially women like Marilyn Monroe, who becomes a sex symbol of the 1950s. You know, not only are women suggesting that they can be, again, more open and free, but the 1920s allowed women to be more flowing and free already. But Marilyn Monroe really pushed that envelope forward and said, no, women can be sexy, like openly just sexy. And so she became a sex symbol of the 1950s. And in 1955, Playboy released its first issue in 1955, thus again changing the social landscape for women. Now, there's a lot of debate about Playboy. Does Playboy represent the objectification of women? That men only buy this magazine to look at women and therefore women are viewed as objects? Or does this show that women who choose to be in this magazine represent this feminist revolution where women can take control of their own bodies and share with everyone else what they believe to be sexy and what they believe to be beautiful? I think it depends on who you talk to in that debate, but it really is a debate that, you know, is had even today. You know, what is Playboy's role? I mean, these women aren't being forced to, you know, be put in these magazines, but at the same time, is this the best foot forward we want for women? And so kind of just depends on how you see it. But yeah, is the role of women changing? Is the perception of women changing? Most definitely. And did you see something similar in the 1920s? Yeah. So again, what? You see 1920s women's culture changing, 1950s women's culture changing, 1920s Red Scare, 1950s Red Scare, 1920s car culture, 1950s car culture. Interesting. Interesting. And then consumerist culture. Was there a 1920s consumer culture? Sure there was. And now there's a 1950s consumer culture. It's like every time there's something called the World War, almost the exact same things happen right after it. Yeah, 1948, McDonald's begins. Serving one of the first fast foods in America. Fun fact though, they're not the first drive-thru. That honor is given to who? In-N-Out. In-N-Out is the first drive-thru, and then McDonald's like, I like that idea, and so they went along with it as well. But yeah. 15 cents. Cheap. This is pre-Ronald McDonald. This is pre-clown McDonald's. You also have the introduction of credit cards for the first time. Credit cards emerge at this time. Is this similar to the 1920s? Sure, in the 1920s, did they have credit cards, though? No, they bought on credit. In the 1950s, they buy with credit. Make sense? They actually have a credit card with them now. Back in the 1920s, you go to Sears and be like, I'd like to buy this couch. Oh, don't worry. Just come back every month and pay a little bit of it. Isn't that exactly what a credit card is? But there was no physical card yet. But in the 1950s, they're like, oh, yeah, here's a credit card and just mail in your payment every month. And so credit cards change over time. And here you have two different credit cards of the 1950s. Again, are people spending a lot more now? Most definitely. So again, with credit cards, you see the increase of credit spending. This goes up and up and up because people want to buy more and more things. You know, things like a TV and, oh, thank goodness, Tupperware. Tupperware is pretty awesome for most of you, except for that one frustrating morning when you wake up and you wonder, where is the lid for my Tupperware? And you wonder why, because you live alone and you've bought six containers of Tupperware, and yet for some reason, you only have three, and you don't know where they are. Or the more frustrating, you've bought Tupperware over the years, you have six different kinds of Tupperware, and you can't find the lid for the one Tupperware that you've already put food in. So then you have to put the food in another Tupperware, and you just double the dishes you have to clean. Very frustrating. Then Disneyland emerges in 1955. That's pretty cool. When Disneyland first opened in 1955, guys, how many lands were there? Not including Main Street, which is not a land. Three. Who can name the three lands Disneyland originally opened in 1955? Marisol? Huh?
Florida.
Florida? The three lands originally created. No, Disneyland was in California. Florida has Disney World, but by the way, that wasn't my question. Alejandro. Tomorrowland is one. Carissa? Frontierland is two. Who can name the third one? No, Toontown is like 1990s. You're 0 for 2. Carissa. Fantasy? Nope, not yet. Adventureland. Adventureland. Fantasy will come very soon after, though. Very, very soon after. But yeah, Disneyland emerges. Of the 9 people that came that first year, 6 million of them were from out of state. So again, what drove them there? Freeways, highways, you know, cars, that kind of thing. So again, Disneyland emerges. By the way, Disneyland also not the first amusement park. Does anyone know? Knott's Berry Farm. Knott's Berry Farm was the first amusement park. Pretty much it was just a farm, and he put attractions on there to attract people to come to his farm and buy produce and also ride the rides. Disney sound like, I like that idea, and actually Knott's helped Disney build Disneyland. Yep. Stories. Televisions also emerge at this time. By the 1960s, 90% of families have homes. And look how big that television is compared to that baby. And look how small that television screen is compared to that baby. Did you see my new TV? It's a sweet 12 inches diameter. Very impressive. Very impressed with my new television. In any case, folks, this new TV by 1960, about 90% of families all had televisions. As a result, fewer and fewer people will go where? Movies, because TVs are available now. So movie theaters will decline. But new TV shows emerge. For example, The Honeymooners. The Honeymooners is a new television show emerges at this time, where Ralph Cramden is always telling his wife, Alice, you know, he's always like upset and frustrated. They're like, one of these days, Alice, one of these days. Bang! Zoom! Right to the moon! And then, you know, the people, like, everyone would always like, ha ha! It's like the laughter. It's not funny, guys. That's domestic abuse. He's going to beat his wife. Bang! Zoom! Right to the one of these days, I'm going to beat you so badly, it's going to be bang, zoom, right to the moon. And domestic abuse is hilarious in the 1950s. It shouldn't be. It's pretty horrible. It's like the audience, when the camera's turned off, he's going to beat his wife senseless. Hilarious. Not hilarious. But that's the 1950s. Other TV shows? The Ed Sullivan Show. Ed Sullivan was pretty popular. It was kind of like the late night show with David Letterman or the Tonight Show with Jay Leno. And so these kinds of TV shows would bring in stars, the Beatles, Elvis Presley, Buddy Holly, Justin Bieber. And they would come on and they would perform. And again, it was just one way actors would come. It was like a talk show, a late night show. And so Ed Sullivan Show was pretty popular. And of course, I Love Lucy emerges on one of the first TV shows. Very popular TV shows. I mean, again, are there a lot of channels at this time, folks, in the 1960s? No, there's like 12. And so is everyone pretty much watching the same thing?
Yeah.
Yes. And so, again, you see conformity being promoted. You see this American culture being promoted in television as well. So you have conformity, again, being pushed by television. Okay? Conformity is pushing television, just like radio pushed conformity in the 1920s. You have TV pushing conformity. I Love Lucy, by the way, was one of the first breakthrough shows because they had a lot of firsts or a lot of popular firsts. I mean, they might not have been the first, but they were the most prominent of the time. For example, the first interracial couple on television. Desi was Cuban. Lucy, Caucasian. First interracial couple on television. Also, the first couple married on TV that were actually married in real life. That's also a first. She's also the first pregnant woman to be pregnant on TV. She's a pregnant woman playing a pregnant woman on television. Before, you would just pretend to be pregnant. But she's actually a pregnant woman who's pregnant on TV. And they never said pregnant, though. It's not allowed. You say with child. Because pregnant was gross. It's not appropriate. Not for children's ears. But with child, it's like, oh, now I get it. The other thing is that this is also the first episode where they talked about her giving birth on television. It's not like they watched like the baby coming out or anything, but like, no, they talked about a woman having a child on television. And because she had a child on television, she's the first TV show to have reruns because she wanted to, you know, stay with her kid for about a year. And so people thought, that's crazy. Who the heck is going to want to watch the same TV show over and over again? And they realized this was golden. Because now, somewhere around the world, every minute, someone is watching I Love Lucy. because it's syndicated across the world. So somewhere, every minute, someone is watching I Love Lucy, and they're making money off of that still today. Because it's syndicated, because they own the rights. But again, I mean, reruns, I watch reruns all the time. I'll watch the same show over and over again just because. But again, the basic idea is I Love Lucy is does a lot of firsts. Here are my favorite moments of I Love Lucy. Oops.
What are you doing up here? I thought you were downstairs boxing chocolates.
Oh, they kicked me out of there fast.
Why?
I kept pinching them to see what kind they were.
The fourth apartment I've been in.
Oh, I didn't do so well either.
All right, girls. Oh, this is our last chance.
So, two very famous I Love Lucy episodes. In any case, that's TV. Now let's talk about teen culture. So how is teen culture changing at this time? Well, there are a few things that are happening with teen culture. The expectations are the following of the 1950s if you're a teen. Obey authority. Also control your emotions. You know, don't get sad, don't get loud, don't get mad. Be calm. Don't make waves. What does that mean, don't make waves? Don't start trends, but like, don't cause drama. You know, you don't want like people start talking about you and people start knowing. Don't make waves. Fit in with the group. And don't even think about sex. And don't even think about sex. And so these are the expectations of the 1950s. You know, the clean-shaven teen was expected to follow all of these expectations. Now, do you think teens of the 1950s would be willing to listen to all of these? Now, I mean, some people, sure, the clean-shaven teen, the clean teen, as we would call it, might be willing to listen to these rules. But many people were not, and so you see this social rebellion beginning, and a lot of it is inspired by music at the time. You would see a social rebellion, not like a violent rebellion, but like a social rebellion, like we're going to do things our way, you know, the teen rebellion. A lot of this teen culture, this social rebellion, is inspired by people like Elvis Presley. Elvis Presley, who inspires this teen rebellion at the time. Oops, what am I doing? And again, you might know Elvis Presley from this music. So again, very popular. And so you look at music like Elvis, and is it loud? Does it make you want to dance? You know, like, you know, he shakes and gyrates his hips and makes girls and boys think of sex all the time. I mean, remember, like, the way he dances is the dance of the devil. And so parents hated Elvis because he's always like dancing and gyrating on stage, and parents are like, what is that? That's not appropriate. And so girls would fall crazy because they didn't understand like the weird feelings they were having because Elvis was, you know, dancing and gyrating on stage. And men were like, that guy is cool. Leather jacket, yelling on the microphone, rock guitar, dancing all crazy. Like, that's what girls like. I want to do that too. And so Elvis was part of this rock and roll rebellion of teens wanting to express themselves, not be so clean-shaven, not having to fit within this mold that society had designed for them. Also, Elvis was pretty nonconformist in that he was inspired by black music, and so this is known as colored music, because rock and roll guys, was inspired by blues, jazz. I mean, Elvis was a pretty great musician. It was known as colored music, and so many white Americans thought that you can't listen to Elvis because he's inspired by blacks. blacks like his music, so whites shouldn't like his music. So that was, again, one of these unique things of the American story. Also, you have Buddy Holly. Buddy Holly is also a famous rock and roll star at the time. You know, part of this teen culture rebellion. Again, very famous Buddy Holly, "That'll Be the Day." So again, another rock and roll star. Maybe it's not as loud as Elvis, but still, you know, the songs and the lyrics, "That'll Be the Day," you can do whatever you want. Yeah, eventually you do that. We'll see if that happens or not. So it's like questioning, you know, authority, questioning society, questioning the roles and the rules of society. And so again, part of that teen rebellion, you know, instead of being a doctor or a lawyer, here he is, you know, making his life as a musician. And not even good music, like, you know, singing. What are you singing about? You know, playing a guitar and drums, that's too loud, much, much too loud. And of course you have Chuck Berry, the very famous Chuck Berry. Yeah. So very famous Chuck Berry also. Again, black music, very loud, screaming in a microphone. Why do you want to listen to that? It's so loud. But again, it allowed teens to express themselves and their frustrations with the mold that they were being forced into. So again, it's part of that teen experience. In any case, the teens and the critics of the 1950s eventually become known as the Beatniks. The Beatniks of the 1950s. And these are all Beatniks. Because this guy right here, this guy in the corner, this is what we like to call a clean teen. You know, shade, like really nice hair, plaid shirt tucked in with no khaki pants and a belt. He probably was like, "Oh, mother, father, I was curious if you would be willing to partake in a jolly good game of golf." You know, that's not what I want to be. I mean, this is what we refer to as squares. And this guy's such a square. You guys understand the term square? The person, you just want to fit in that mold. You're equal on all sides. Why don't you want to be different? Exactly. Equal like everyone else. You're such a square. Why do you want to be a square? Why don't you be cool and hip and jive, you know? You want to be a hip cat or a cool turkey? I mean, why don't you be something awesome? And so, really what you have are the beatniks. I mean, this guy is a beatnik, you know, unclean, unkempt, you know, shirt, he wears whatever he wants, this is whatever music. These eventually become the more stereotypical look of the beatniks. You know, the beret, the cigarette, like, that's not very good. You know, usually French, I guess, are examples of the beatniks. So they're different. They drink coffee at, like, you know, at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and you know, they listen to like really weird music. And again, these are also good examples of beatniks down here. Again, they're not clean shaven, they have long hair. Some of them will wear suits, whatever else, but again, the culture is that they're all nonconformists. The beatnik culture is about being nonconformists, that they're not gonna go along with society. They're gonna find their own beat. They're gonna go ahead and walk their own path. They're nonconformists. So again, people are like, "Oh, you like all that music they're playing nowadays? For us, no, us beatniks, no, we like our own kind of music. This is what I call a pencil on a desk." Yeah. You know, that's music. Don't you feel it? That's the music. You feel it coursing through you, the rhythms. That's life. That's what music is all about. It helped that they were all doing drugs to make that actually sound good. But again, this is kind of the beatnik generation critiquing. And again, is this similar to the lost generation of the 1920s? Again, they didn't like the conformity. They didn't like what was happening in society. So again, the 1950s and 1920s are very similar. So should you eventually maybe compare those two? likely have to compare this to an essay of some degree? Probably. That'd probably likely be a good possibility. Music and teen culture was also promoted. These are two different beatniks. You have Jack Kerouac and Allen Ginsberg, who wrote On the Road and Howl. So these are just two examples of beatniks who criticized the 1950s and the conformist culture. Jack Kerouac, On the Road, and Allen Ginsberg, Howl. Both beatniks, again, nonconformists, who criticized this 1950s culture. Okay. Then also movies promoted this 1950s rebel culture. James Dean, for example, in Rebel Without a Cause. Very famous movie about teens that just can't take it anymore. You know, their parents are pressuring them and bullies at school and all the pressures of graduation, and you can't say this or you can't do that or you can't make waves. I mean, we just can't take it anymore as teens. And so James Dean in Rebel Without a Cause did a really good job of exemplifying the frustrations that teens had with this mold that they were expected to fit in. And James Dean said, I'm just not going to do it anymore. I'm not going to take it. So in the movie Rebel Without a Cause, you have this, again, this teen rebellion that we'll see right here. It's a trailer for the movie. Seems like an overreaction to kiss on the cheek.
No. No, I don't want you to go to the police. There are other people. Why should you be the only one involved? We are all involved.
Mom, a boy, a kid was killed tonight.
Now, this is all going too fast
for me. You better give me something. You better give me something fast.
Jimmy, you're very young. A boy's decision not to wreck your whole life. In 10 years, you'll never know this even happened.
That ain't for her.
Dan, out!
You want to kill your own father?
Jimmy!
I'd watch that. Seems like a good movie. So, that's the culture of the 1950s. Now, things are good, I guess. Things seem exciting despite the teen rebellions. And then you realize, oh, right. And then there are civil rights problems still. So, let's talk about civil rights during the 1950s. What progress have blacks made in the 1950s, what we're going to be talking about today? What progress has been made for the black community with regard to civil rights during the 1950s? So, by the 1950s, they are still having problems with Jim Crow laws and lynching. So, again, we freed the slaves back in 1865. That was a long time ago. That was about 90 years ago. And yet, has much really changed for them in the South? Not too much. They're still being discriminated against. Segregation is still a problem. Jim Crow laws are a problem. Lynching is still a problem. And so we're going to have to fight these problems because it's still somewhat of a serious, serious issue in the South. Well, we do begin addressing the problems in the 1950s. We will start addressing the problems in the 1950s of lynching, Jim Crow, segregation, that kind of thing. But the one person we're not going to turn to fix the problems of segregation and civil rights, the one person who's not going to help us, President Eisenhower. Eisenhower refuses to be a civil rights president. He just doesn't want to be. He believes that states should decide for themselves what the role of, you know, civil rights and black rights should be in the South, and not the federal government. So he refuses to be a civil rights president. So he does not support civil rights for blacks, which is interesting. But because of this, it's considered to be his biggest failure as president, for failing to act on civil rights. And what I mean by this is that there will be a situation in which Eisenhower will be forced to step in. But he will not be the president that will move forward and say, I will end segregation for blacks. I will fix black rights. He did not want to be that president. I mean, did Truman at least do things for blacks, like proactively? Yeah, he passed the Civil Rights Commission. He made sure that he desegregated the military and the federal government. So Truman actually did things as president to try to help blacks. Eisenhower does not believe that's his role. He will say, no, it's not my responsibility. The South is going to have to figure it out on its own. So again, not ideal for Southern blacks to have a president that does not feel that it is his responsibility to fix their problems. Make sense so far? Okay. So, one of the things that Eisenhower does do is he appoints Earl Warren to be the 14th Supreme Court Justice. Chief Justice, rather. The 14th Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, or the 14th Supreme Court Chief Justice. Why are there only 14 and yet we have 34 presidents? Because they serve for life. Sometimes they can serve for like 20 years. This guy served for 16. That's that could be up to four presidents. Actually, he serves under what? Eisenhower, Johnson, Kennedy, Nixon. Yeah, he was under four presidents. He's appointed by Eisenhower. Now, Eisenhower appointed him because he thought he was a conservative. He appointed him because he believed that he would not change society too much. It turned out, though, that he was pretty progressive, and he was like, ah, crap, this is not why I appointed you. And eventually, Eisenhower will consider the appointment of Earl Warren as one of his biggest mistakes because he did change a lot for blacks, and Eisenhower did not want that to be his legacy. But again, he was appointed because everyone thought he was a conservative. His record showed he was a conservative. But once he became Supreme Court Chief Justice, it turned out he was actually pretty progressive when it came to certain things, like black rights. Everyone good? Everyone ready? So here's what he did and what we did to fight for black rights. First important Supreme Court case. Brown v. Board of Education of Topeka, Kansas. For your purposes, you really only need to know Brown versus Board of Education, but it just happened to be in Topeka, Kansas. Brown v. Board of Education, or Brown v. Board, or Brown v. Board of Education of Topeka, Kansas, 1954. Julie, we talked about this. No sneezing. So, you have the Supreme Court case, and what is happening in this picture that do you think this Supreme Court case will do? Yes, it ends segregation, but let's talk about it first. Linda Brown, this cute little 9-year-old, she wants to go to school, she wants to go to better school. And so she is represented by Thurgood Marshall. Thurgood Marshall will represent her in her case against the Brown Board of Education, or rather the Board of Education in Topeka, Kansas. Because she wants to go to a good school, and who can blame her? By the way, I should make it clear, she didn't sue on her own. Her parents were involved. It wasn't like she was fully aware of how the American court system worked. She wanted to go to school. Her parents wanted her to go to an all-white school also. But she was denied, and so they sued, and Thurgood Marshall represented them. Ultimately, they argued that segregation was unequal. They argued that segregation was unequal. The case went all the way up to the Supreme Court. Earl Warren heard the case, and ultimately he decides, you're right. Segregation is unequal, and they overturned the Supreme Court case of Plessy v. Ferguson, which said what? It's okay to have segregation if it's separate but equal. What Plessy v. Ferguson, or rather what Brown v. Board did, was it overturned Plessy v. Ferguson and ruled that separate but equal was inherently unequal. Separate but equal was inherently unequal. Because just because you say, oh, they'll be equal, if you have a black school and a white school, is a black school automatically going to be less than the white school? In the South, yes, that is going to be the case. And so they ruled that separate but equal was inherently unequal. And it ruled that segregation in public schools was unconstitutional. It ruled that segregation in public schools was unconstitutional. And I guess another way to put it was that it required the integration of all public schools. It required the integration or desegregation, the same thing. Integration, desegregation, same thing. It required the desegregation or integration of all public schools. So is this a win for blacks? Oh, most definitely, a huge win for blacks. And Eisenhower was pissed. He's like, Earl Warren, this is not why I appointed you. But he can't really do anything about it now, but that's the case. Now, how do whites feel about this? Are they happy about this case? Absolutely not. The whites are livid. They are angry. And so the whites say, we refuse to go to school with blacks. And so in the South, you see the beginning of massive resistance. From 1956 to 1959, you have something called massive resistance, in which whites refuse to attend integrated schools. Whites refuse to attend integrated schools. Even the governments tried to do this. Like the state of Virginia tried to cut off funds to integrated schools. So if you're a school that's integrating, we won't give you money. So again, whites refuse to go to integrated schools, or they refuse to go to school with blacks. If you can see in the picture here, some of the captions say, we, the pupils of this school, Clinton High School, don't want Negroes in our school. We won't go to school with Negroes. Strike against integration of Clinton High School. Negroes not wanted in the North or South. Send them back to Africa where God Almighty put them to begin with. That is their home. No Negro or ape allowed in building. No nigger or Negro allowed inside building. And yet, ironically, right in the window is a picture of Jesus. So again, I don't know how one is able to reconcile horribly racist sentiments with, I think Jesus would be cool with this. Yeah, I know he said love thy neighbor. I think he meant love thy white neighbor. The mistranslation. But in any case, you have this going on. You have this racism, and whites refuse to go to school with blacks. And so you also see the rise of what in this time? That if people are angry, you see the rise of what? Actually, ghosts. Ghosts. The KKK come to power again at this time. Similar to after the 1920s, right? Again, you had this race issue in the 1920s as well. So the KKK come back to power. And here they are again at their weekly meeting. You can't tell, but they're all making funny faces. This is their silly picture. In any case, it's after the serious one that he took beforehand. In any case, so the KKK comes to power and schools become a problem. Eventually, the federal government will force them to end massive resistance. Eventually, federal government will force schools to end massive resistance. Eventually, we will force schools to end massive resistance because they're disobeying the law. But before that happens, you have other events that kind of promote massive resistance. Here they are again. Eisenhower's going to do nothing about the problem. Here's Eisenhower looking over the fire, and he says, the civil rights crisis, and then Eisenhower says someone should really do something about that civil rights problem, because is he going to do anything about it? No, because he says, I don't want to be civil rights president. I'm not going to be that president. Someone should do something about it, but it's not going to be me. And again, here's the massive resistance laws, and then the Supreme Court will eventually prevent Virginia and other southern states from promoting them, but that's not until 1959. Now, the next key event is crisis in Little Rock, Arkansas. So we talked about massive resistance just recently, like literally seconds ago. And in Little Rock, Arkansas, Governor Orville Faubus, he decided that he was not going to integrate schools. He refused to integrate schools. And so what he did was he used the National Guard to prevent black students from entering the schools. So he used the National Guard to prevent 9 black students from entering the school, Central High School in Little Rock. So he really doesn't want black kids to integrate into white schools. And so he sends the National Guard to prevent them from entering. He literally puts the guard around the school and the blacks are not allowed to come in. He's going to prevent them from coming in. Now, is this a violation of federal law? Yes, it is. Because did the Supreme Court rule that schools have to be integrated? Yes, they did. And so he's breaking federal law. That's something you guys should know. This is a violation of federal law. This is a violation of Brown v. Board. It's a violation, guys. He can't do that. It's a violation of Brown v. Board or a violation of federal law. So Eisenhower is not in favor of desegregation, but does he have to uphold the law? He doesn't want to be a president that lets states do whatever they want, very much like Lincoln, right? Lincoln is not for freeing the slaves, but is he going to let the states just break away? No, he's not. Very similar in that sense. And so Eisenhower is not going to let him do that. And so I'm going to show you a quick video, and then we'll talk about the aftermath. Here's the response to Governor Orville Faubus and the Little Rock Nine.
What about you, sir? Do you think the college students will show up? If I got anything to do with it, they won't show up. Well, I think it's a breaking point of the school integration. I just don't feel that they have a right to go to school.
It is easy to believe today that we are in a enlightened society, free from problems of race, gender, or economic separation. But some of the most difficult lessons we learn are a result of individuals who push us through these divisive barriers. In September 1957, 9 black school children, the eldest only 17, forced us through such a blockade. They sought a better education for themselves and the opportunity to pursue the American dream.
This is Central High School, Little Rock, Arkansas. Troops, which for nearly 3 weeks lined the sidewalk here in front of the high school under orders to keep the colored students out, have been replaced now from their orders to comply with the law, which means let the Negro students in if they come in.
We were Terrence Roberts and Jefferson Thomas, former militia, Elizabeth Eckford, Ernest Green, Carlotta Wall, Mother Patello, Minnie Jean Brown, and Gloria Ray.
They became known as the Little Rock Nine. The 1954 Supreme Court ruling on Brown versus the Board of Education found segregation of schools unconstitutional. It was the Little Rock Nine approached the high school. Segregationists swarmed the campus.
I got no business out here. There's not a school out there,
but
there are
now. As the violence escalated, one schoolgirl, Elizabeth Eckford, was threatened by an angry mob chanting, "Lyncher, Lyncher." President Dwight Eisenhower intervened in Little Rock and set a precedent for our nation as a whole.
Such an extreme situation has been created in Little Rock. This challenge must be met, and with such measures that will preserve to the people as a whole their lawfully protected rights in a climate permitting their free and fair exercise. In the present case, the troops are there pursuant to law solely for the purpose of preventing interference with the orders of the court.
On September 25th, 1957, the 101st Airborne Division, the 10,000 National Guard troops, escorted the robot nine as they walked bravely past screen locks and made their way to the classrooms at Little Rock Central High School.
Just got a report here on this end that the students are in.
You feel the voice that going through this?
Yes, I do. These nine heroes were willing to step forward and in doing so altered the course of history. Marquette University is honored to bestow upon them the Pierre Marquette Discovery Award for this extraordinary contribution to the advancement of education for all people. The Robot Nine stand not just for racial equality, but also for the promise upon which our society is founded. Opportunity and equality for all, willing to strive, struggle, and achieve.
So, you guys see that, were people happy with the integration of the schools? No. In fact, people were protesting outside, saying, no, we're not going to allow them to integrate in the schools. Governor Orville Faubus, he sent out the military to prevent these nine blacks from going into the schools. And here again, they saw the picture of that one girl who had to walk on her own, and they were like screaming, lynch her, kill her, kill her. And so, what did Eisenhower have to do because Governor Orville Faubus was breaking the law? What was his response? Who did he send in? The U.S. Army. So, I mean, pretty much, folks, what happened is that this group called the Little Rock Nine, they are the ones that wanted to go to school at this all-white school because they wanted a better education. And in doing so, they had to walk through that challenge of all those people yelling at them. Now, how many of you would have the capacity and strength to be able to go through that? I mean, in all honesty, have an entire group of people yelling at you, saying they're going to kill you. They might very well kill you. And so these nine kids went ahead and said, okay, you know, if we're going to take a stand, let's do that. And they were willing to, I mean, literally die for what they believed in, because could at any moment they have been shot or killed? Sure, because those people were crazy. Well, in order to protect the lives of these nine kids, but also to make sure that the law was being enforced, Eisenhower sent in 10,000 troops to escort the Little Rock Nine. So, in order to ensure that the law was followed, Eisenhower sent in 10,000 troops to escort the Little Rock Nine. Now, is Eisenhower doing this because he believes in desegregation? He's doing this why? Because he has to enforce the law. He's doing it because that's the law. Not because he agrees with it, because it's his job to enforce the law. So Eisenhower sends in 10,000 troops to enforce this law. And the entire time, these people are pissed off and angry. They want to kill these kids. And so this army escorts them wherever they go. They walk them, they surround them when they go to school, they surround them when they go home. And it got bad, folks. I mean, the people were angry. And when the kids finally get into the school, you saw how angry those people were. Like, they finally walked into the school, and they were angry about this happening. They started rioting outside. They started attacking random black people that were just in the audience. They, in fact, took a brick, and they smacked them behind the head. One guy had a concussion as a result of it. They were screaming, lynch him, kill him, get him out of there. And they killed them. And so the local police officer said, what do you want us to do? He said, bring one of them out. We'll lynch one of them. I think it'll make these people happier. And so they brought out the nine kids. And then the people thought they were going to get to choose which one to lynch. But then they put them in police cars and they said, drive and don't stop. And they got them out of there. But again, this is how bad it got. That these people are willing to kill people in order to prevent this from happening. And yet, it went through. Eventually, these kids did get to attend school. But again, I mean, ultimately, Little Rock Nine allowed for... Pretty much the significance was that the federal government was going to enforce desegregation. The federal government was going to enforce desegregation. So is this a victory for the civil rights movement? Sure. I mean, yes, people are still horribly, horribly racist, but we're forcing it through even if they don't agree. Again, it's a success because the federal government was going to enforce desegregation. Questions? Okay. Following that, folks, we passed the Civil Rights Act of 1957. civil rights in that act, a civil rights commission was created to investigate violations of civil rights, or to investigate civil rights violations. So again, in 1957, they created the Civil Rights Act. This was designed to create a civil rights commission to investigate civil rights violations, you know, to see if people's rights were being taken away from them, they were being denied jobs because they were black, or they were being denied access to schools because they were black. So they're supposed to investigate civil rights violations. And they instituted injunctions to protect voting rights. What's an injunction again? It makes things what? If you have an injunction, if I have an injunction on, I don't know, making bread, what does that do? You can't make bread. It makes making bread illegal. And so what the injunction did was that it made voter suppression illegal. So let's say my desk represents, I don't know, voting poll, the polling area. And so me and my friends, we had like, you know, sticks, and we're standing outside there trying to intimidate blacks from voting. State was not very effective. But will that intimidate some blacks? They have guns walking around parading, people in KKK uniforms walking around. You can't do that anymore. Because they'll put like a 1 mile radius against voting areas saying that you cannot be there during a polling year, during a polling day. And so the idea was it was supposed to prevent voting suppression. Cool. Is that a victory? Yeah, it's going to allow more blacks to vote. Then the Rosa Parks incident. You guys know the Rosa Parks incident, right? She got on a bus. She sat where? In the back of the bus. But then why did she get in trouble? True. Here's what happened, guys. Typically on this on these buses, there would be a chain with a sign that would say, like, no, whites only before this line. There'd be a line. So she was sitting on the bus, and she was sitting where the line was right about here. So she sat right behind it in the black section. And as the bus got fuller and fuller and fuller, they moved the sign back. And so she said, okay, well, I'm not going to get up. And they asked her to get up, and she said no. As a result, she was arrested, thus beginning this boycott movement. Now, is she the first person to do this? No, she is not the first person to refuse to give up her seat, but she's the one who becomes the symbol of this protest, because the other two were not the most ideal candidates. One of them was like a teenage mother, and that was not ideal. And then the other one was like cussing and swearing and fighting when she got off the bus. They're like, oh, that's not a very good ideal either. And so Rosa Parks was very quiet. She was calm. She was very nice about the whole thing. She's like, I am not going to get up. She refused. She was educated. She was a great role model. And so the Rosa Parks incident becomes kind of the symbol that we're going to go ahead and use. And so she's unfairly taken off the bus because the buses, again, are segregated, right? So she's taken off this bus because of the bus segregation laws. And as a result, Martin Luther King organizes the Montgomery bus boycott. So in response to the unfairness, Martin Luther King begins the Montgomery bus boycott. What happens is that they refuse. African Americans boycott the bus system until what? They're going to boycott the bus system until they what? What do they want them to do? Why are they boycotting? What do they want to happen? Yes, what do we call that? They want to desegregate the buses. So again, they agree to boycott the bus system until the bus system is desegregated. Or they boycott for the desegregation of buses. Another way to put it. Will this prove effective? Yes, and here's one of the major reasons why. In the city of Montgomery, 80% of bus users are black. So is that going to take a major toll on the bus system in the South. Yeah, it is. This boycott will last 400 days. This boycott will last 400 days. Now imagine, many of these people have to walk to work now, but they say it's worth it. So this boycott will last for over 400 days, and it will end when the Supreme Court rules that bus segregation is unconstitutional. Again, the boycott ends after 400 days when the Supreme Court rules that bus segregation is unconstitutional. Let's watch what happened. So what would happen is that Martin Luther King, they would give people rides. If you had a car, you'd drive as many people as you could. They'd have like free taxis. If you didn't work but you had a car, you would drive people to and from work. You had like these little shuttles. And so 444 days, and again, they were willing. And what they realized at the Montgomery bus boycott was that when they were angry, did they bomb buses? Did they like throw bombs and destroy them and slash tires? No. They had a peaceful protest. And so when Martin Luther King successfully leaves the Montgomery bus boycott, they think, this guy knows what he's doing. And so eventually he's put in charge and becomes president of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. And the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, again, decides that it becomes their goal to promote desegregation. The Southern Christian Leadership Conference decides it's going to be their goal to desegregate society, to desegregate America, for desegregation. And they're going to do it through what? They're going to desegregate America through what? That's one example, but more generally, how are they going to promote desegregation? Peaceably or non-violent resistance. Or civil disobedience. So they decide that our way to fight for civil rights is through nonviolent resistance or civil disobedience. They're going to fight for desegregation through nonviolent resistance or civil disobedience. Now, Martin Luther King was inspired by which transcendentalist author? Who wrote on civil disobedience? Who can raise their hand and tell me? Who wrote it? Alejandro? Henry David Thoreau. Very good. So Henry David Thoreau wrote on civil disobedience, which is about peaceful protest. Martin Luther King will eventually inspire who? Gandhi. But again, nonviolent resistance. If you want what you want and you're angry, you're supposed to fight back? No, you're supposed to peacefully protest. So they promote nonviolent resistance. No, love one's enemy. Change the minds of your oppressors through moral arguments. That was the argument that he made. In any case, folks, one of the movements that are inspired then is the sit-in movement. The most famous being in Greensboro, North Carolina. In particular, this is known as the Woolworths sit-in. Woolworths, folks, is like a diner. It's like a Johnny Rockets, a 1950s diner. And were restaurants segregated? Were restaurants segregated back then? Yeah. Because, I mean, Brown v. Board only desegregated public schools. The Supreme Court only desegregated bus systems. But America is still pretty segregated. Restaurants, these private businesses, they're still segregated. And so what happened was these four black students from the University of North Carolina, they went ahead and they sat in the diner in the white section. And the black waitress refused to serve them, saying, "What are you guys doing? Get out of here, or go sit in the black section where you're supposed to." Because were there blacks that did not want to make waves? Were there blacks that wanted to just keep things the same and calm and not create problems? Yeah, she said, "Get out of here, go sit in the right section." But they refused. They said no. And they were refused service. So the next day, they returned with 19 people. And those 19, again, sat in the whites-only section. This is a combination of blacks and whites, and they were harassed for it. They poured ketchup on their heads, milkshakes, spit in their faces, cursed at them, poured salt and sugar, pepper on them. And yet, how did they respond? They just sat there peacefully. And they said, "History will remember me as a hero while history remembers you as a monster." And they just sat there. Now, how many of you would have the self-control to be able to sit there, have people yell at you, spit in your face, curse at you, and you only get to sit there? It's not easy. It's hard. I mean, I would argue that I have the temperament to be able to do that. You know, I have a pretty even temper. I don't lose my temper very often. I think I'd be fine. But I always say, you know, but if they didn't do their homework and they did this, oh, not okay. So, yeah. So it's fine if they dump stuff on me, but if they also didn't do their homework, I mean, I'd get angry. I'd become the Hulk. Yes. Because whites and blacks, whites that also promoted integration, they joined the sit-in movement. Because again, it's not only blacks that wanted integration. It's whites, Latinos, Asians. They all believed that integration should happen because it was the right thing to do. Now, were there racists in all groups? Of course. There were blacks that felt that this was a bad idea. There were blacks that said, integration, what's the point? Blacks should have theirs and whites should have theirs. But there were many that believed that integration was the way to go. And so whites were being attacked if they were sitting at the same time. Like, "You're crazy. No, you've been infected with what they have." But in any case, the sit-in movement, this is the next day with 19 kids. The following day, 85 students. And by the end of the week, 1,000.
That many sit in the diner?
Well, I mean, they would sit everywhere they could. They would sit on the floor, they would stand, sit on counters, sit through the doors, sit wherever they could. But the whole point is they will sit there until it's desegregated. Now, eventually, this becomes a popular form of protest. And you'll see other movements begin. You have sit-ins here. Eventually, you'll see kneel-ins at churches. Kneel-ins, you know, churches, cemeteries, whatever. You'll see read-ins at libraries, so kneel-ins, read-ins, wade-ins at beaches, and sleep-ins at motels. And all of these are segregated. So the goal is to have, you know, sleep-ins, read-ins, wade-ins, kneel-ins, sit-ins. The basic idea is we're going to go ahead and fight against segregation, but we're going to do it what? Peacefully. We will not fight back. So these actually proved to be very successful. Well, Martin Luther King and the SCLC see how successful these college students are becoming, so they decide to organize them. And they organize them and they create SNCC, or Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC. Not to be confused with SNCC, S-N-I-C-K, which is Nickelodeon after 8 p.m. in the 90s, where you got to watch cool things like The Adventures of Pete and Pete and The Mystery Files of Shelby Woo and Are You Afraid of the Dark? Cool TV shows for teenagers, for kids. Now you have Nick at Night after that, which is like old school 1950s shows, but SNCC was a place to be on a Friday, Saturday night. If you're not going out to watch movies, you watch SNCC. It competed with ABC's TGI Fridays, where they had like those shows, Full House, Family Matters, Boy Meets World. 90s were awesome, guys. Anyway, Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, its job was again to promote civil rights. Their goal was to fight civil rights because they believed that Martin Luther King was moving too slowly. They eventually believe that MLK is moving too slowly with SCLC, so students become more involved. And their slogan is jail, not bail. What does that mean? Jail, not bail. Yeah, go to jail and you stay there because you're protesting, right? If there's 1,000 people in jail, then let's make that their problem. But are you willing to go to jail? Yes, you let yourself get arrested. That's the point. You disobey, you know you're disobeying, and you will go to jail, but you're fighting for a good cause, so you don't care if you go to jail. In fact, that's the point. You go to jail and you make it really inconvenient for them to arrest 1,000 people and put them in the jail. Because what are they going to do, put 1,000 people in jail? They're going to have to. You arrest one of us, you arrest all of us. But that's the basic idea of this. Everyone quote the Civil Rights Movement. Is this successful for them? Sure. So the questions now become, here are the three questions you should know. You already wrote down the first one, so let's worry about the other two. Oh, fun fact, next week on Thursday, Friday, you will have an in-class essay on Truman or Eisenhower. And it will be on either social issues or Cold War issues, and it will be on one of those two presidents, but I'm not going to tell you which. So now we're going to start getting into the habit of having you write essays without having the topic ahead of time. You guys need to start getting prepared for the AP test. So, next Thursday, Friday, you will have an essay on Truman and Eisenhower. I won't tell you which president. I won't tell you if it's about the Cold War or domestic policies like these. But you need to start preparing for these essays. You need to start preparing. You're writing well. Now it's about, will you write the same level when you're put under a time constraint and you're being surprised with the question? Was it a time of happy days or anxiety, alienation, and social unrest? Let's go with Christine. What do you think? In your assessment, was it a time of happy days or anxiety, alienation, and social unrest? In your opinion, if you had to write this essay, how would you argue it? Anxiety, because it may be the Cold War, civil rights movement, racism. Teen rebellion. People weren't so happy with that. Sure, yeah, you can make that argument. Cynthia Escaleta, what about you? Happy days, anxiety, what do you think? Both? Why would you, yeah, so you can talk about what was happy about these times? Yeah, the culture is still pretty good, right? I mean, you have the television, consumer culture, I mean, movies, TV shows. I mean, you still have positive, I mean, civil rights had successes. It wasn't just racism, it was successes as well. So, I mean, if you had to argue this, it was always best to argue both. Most definitely. But yeah, you can talk about here, I mean, this is Cold War stuff. This is more like the beatniks. This is more like civil rights, like teens. But this is like all the awesome stuff. Consumers, civil rights, TVs, all that stuff. I mean, you can write about all this stuff. I mean, exciting things in the 1950s. Were the 1950s a period of conformity or a period of rebellion? Let's go with Zanieri, what do you think? 1950s, conformity, not conformity? Good things, bad things? Both? How were they conformists at this time? Sure, so maybe everyone's joining that same culture again. How is it non-conformist? Go with Anthony. How are they non-conformist? How are they not doing the same? How are they fighting this conformity? Yeah, they're just like desegregation. Rather, I would argue that it's desegregation. I mean, segregation, you could argue, is still conformity because everyone just goes along with the fact that blacks and whites are separate. Desegregation is non-conformist. Don't go along with things. Change the system. Okay, so you would argue that conformity is segregation. Non-conformity is desegregation. You're trying to fight the system. You're trying to break things. What else is a really good example of non-conformity? Let's go with Cynthia Chavez. What else is a good example of non-conformity? Elvis, Buddy Holly, Chuck Berry, Rebel Without a Cause, the teen movement. That's nonconformity. The Beatniks, that's nonconformity. Feminine mystique, that's nonconformity. So you have this changing culture as well emerging in the period of nonconformity. And then another question you might have under Eisenhower is, did Eisenhower increase or decrease tensions during the Cold War? Let's go with Jasmine. I mean, what do you think? Decrease or increase? Or tell me one thing that he did to increase Cold War tensions. What's one thing that he did to increase Cold War tensions? I guess foreign policy or a country he invaded or anything that he did. An incident that happened during his presidency. What's one thing that Eisenhower did to increase... Which one? Oh, but that doesn't affect the Cold War. That's the I'm talking about the Cold War. How did it affect Russia? So I'm talking about previously. What did he do? Like, what things happened internationally or even domestically to make the Cold War hotter or cooler? So Jasmine, I'll come back to you. Yeah, Vanessa. Huh? Rollback. Rollback definitely made it hotter, right? Because he's trying to fight communism. What else would increase or decrease? Julian? U-2 spy plane. Does it increase or decrease? Increased tensions. What else is out there? What else might have increased or decreased? Carla? CETO, increase or decrease? Increased tensions. Yeah, you have someone that's going to fight. Jasmine, what else? Anything that was going to increase or decrease tensions? That would make the Cold War hotter or colder? Yeah, more bang for the buck, that new military. I mean, we're going to use more nuclear weapons, so that's not good. Vanessa? Massive retaliation, definitely going to increase. Yeah. Huh? CETO. Yeah, CETO is, again, one really good example of increasing tensions. Carissa? Brinkmanship going to increase tensions. So, again, you have all these examples of increasing tensions. What were decreasing tensions? What decreased tensions during the Cold War? Alejandro? Which one? Ah, the armistice, sure. So the armistice was helpful. Stalin dying, that's awesome, right? The Geneva summit, that was helpful. Anyone else? Carla? Kitchen debate, that was awful, also helpful. So again, there's a lot of things that you guys can talk about with Eisenhower, right? You can talk about this consumer culture. You can talk about what's happening. You can talk about what he did as president to maybe deal with Cold War issues, anxieties. You can talk about his Cold War problems, you know, making it hotter or colder. And then we're going to have to do the same thing with Truman as well. But again, you have Chapter 38 due on Monday. I would highly recommend that you guys start studying for this. I will give you a worksheet on Monday to help you kind of organize your thoughts for each of these presidents. But you guys need to start preparing for your essay for next week. So start studying, guys. You don't want to study for it the day before. You should start studying now. It's a first real essay you guys are going to have right before the AP test. So start studying. Otherwise, have a good weekend, guys. See you later. Also, I have Power 106 tickets on sale. You guys want to buy them?